G'day guys, welcome to another episode of Covid Convos, where we have real conversations with real people about what wellbeing looks like in a pandemic. I'm fired up to be here, and I'm sure the other boys are too. Kesh, how are you, mate?
Yeah, man, better now that you're fired up.
and Simon, welcome as well.
Thanks, Griggsy. Good to see you.
You too, mate. Now, we've got a very special guest, as we always do. Every guest is special on this show, and Rachel Taylor is here to join us. How are you, Rachel?
I'm good, boys. So happy to be here with you both. Well, all three of you, actually. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, I was wondering which one you weren't happy with.
I'm sure it was definitely.
Probably Kesh.
So, Rachel, would you like to just introduce yourself and tell us what you think or what you'd like people to know about you?
Well, so we're our connection, the three of us, are all graduates of the Masters of Applied Post Psych from Melbourne Uni. I was in the first Melbourne Uni MAP intake, so I go back a long way, and I'm now doing my PhD in the post-psych space, combining it with my other area of interest, which is entrepreneurship and in particular social enterprise. So my PhD is looking at work relationships and in particular energizing relationships within a social enterprise context. And in addition to that research project that I'm doing, I also teach in the entrepreneurship and innovation space, and also do a bit of teaching and research work in the positive psychology space.
Sounds like you've got your hands full there, Rachel, with plenty of, I guess, fingers in different pots, if that's the saying. I'm not really sure that it is now that I've said it, but so just a little bit of a background, as we always like to just check in with our guests. How are you sort of, how's your life been affected thus far with the COVID-19 situation?
Well, the funny thing is I keep saying to people that doing a PhD has actually prepared me really well for these exact circumstances, because I'm now 4 years into the PhD, and that's pretty much been 4 years sitting at home by myself. So I feel very, very prepared. And I was saying to a few people that, in fact, my kind of social life, even though, albeit virtually, has actually gone through the roof in the last few weeks, because normally I'm at home, you know, procrastinating, walking the dogs, anything else, and occasionally working on the PhD, and everyone else is at work. And but now everyone else is at home like I am, so I'm getting a lot more social contact, and just noticing out and about, everyone's more, I think they're more grounded and more able to connect because everyone's just slowed down so much. So but also still very aware that a lot of people are really struggling. You know, I've got friends who are seriously at risk from this virus. I've got friends dealing with very difficult circumstances in their work and their life. And so for me, I'm just trying to navigate how I can be of best of service, because, you know, I'm in a fairly fortunate and lucky position. So for me, it's more about how can I help and what can I do to support others?
I think that's a really important awareness piece. I also have similar feelings, being a bit of an introvert,
yeah,
not really liking people around. I feel like the world is finally my oyster. Everyone has to meet me on my terms. But then I'm connecting into some of my extrovert friends, and they're really suffering. You know, the thought of being isolated for even a week without being able to tap into social connections or go to a bar with some mates and have a chat. It's, you know, it sounds trivial, but to them, that's their self-care. That's how they recharge. That's how you know, they get energy back. So for those of us with energy in this time period, to be able to give that and to think of how do we benefit others is really important, because we're the ones with the energy at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think for me, life being at that slightly slower pace is much more aligned to me and where my energy sits. You know, I'm more a kind of deep thinker processor. So when things are sort of hectic and frenetic, that can sort of diffuse my energy quite quickly. I'm feeling lucky and I'm pretty good at the moment.
Is that something that comes up often in discussions we have on COVID Convos, Rachel, is about what people are doing to sort of turn towards the positive, I suppose, and look after themselves or those around them during this time. And a lot of the time it's about trying to reach out and maintain connection with people. But it sounds as though it's sort of the opposite for you. You're getting more connection with people. But are you noticing a change then, that you've gotten used to that over 4 years and now you sort of want to go and lock yourself in the room when other people are in the house? Or are you doing anything different?
Well, yeah, so there's only the two of us here at home, me and my partner. He's got adult kids and they're based in Europe. So having him around has actually been really nice, because he was in a period of working really, really long hours. And so we hardly saw each other. And he's really enjoying being at home. So that's kind of contributing to me, you know, feeling energized and happy that he's here. And, you know, of course, no one else is allowed to come to the house. So all my connection has been in conversations like these, where, you know, and people have been purposefully making them happen. So, you know, I've been connecting with a few friends that often I'll just, you know, we'll be texting or maybe have a chat from time to time because we don't live in the same city. But we've now had a couple of Zoom sessions like this where we just chat and play a little game that I created that I think we're going to play a bit later. And just have that space to kind of just go, you know, because normally it's hard to catch some of them because they've got little kids. But of course now people just have time and space. And I'm also lucky where I live, which is I live on a property on a, you know, dirt road where there's not a lot of other houses. And so I'm fortunate to be able to get out and be able to walk the dogs and stuff like that. And so I run into neighbours. And so, you know, they'll stop. You know, normally we'll walk past and go, oh, g'day, how you going? But now we'll actually stop 2 metres apart and have a more detailed conversation. So we've gotten to know each other a lot better, and I'm actually feeling a lot more connected just even where I live. Yeah.
I think people are starting to get more creative. So yeah. I think before we started off, just Zoom chat, get online, have a bit of a chat. Now people are sending people recipes, cooking on either side, meeting in the middle, eating food together. I go to this thing called No Lights, No Lycra, which is basically a dance party in the dark. And they're trying to put, they're organizing things so we can do that online now. So that's across the world. I love how people are just being so creative with this. And, you know, have you experienced any creative uses of online space yet?
I have. So I'm a big fan of No Lights, No Lycra as well. I didn't know about that about you, Kesh. So when this is over, we are going together, my friend. So I've joined a Facebook group, which has been just the most incredible source of joy and just fulfillment, which is, I don't know if you guys have heard of it, it's called Adopt a Healthcare Worker. So it started in Perth, and it's just one of these pop-up, someone just had the idea, adopt a healthcare worker. And so now there's a Victorian chapter, and I think there's different, you know, different groups for different states. And so the idea is that, you know, healthcare workers are obviously being absolutely slammed at the moment. they're working really long hours, they're under a lot of pressure. And so they can jump on and go, you know, could someone go to the shops for me? Or could someone walk my dog? Or could someone just have a chat? And they put their postcode. And so the idea is, if you're local, you jump on and say, yep. So I now have two adoptee nurses, which I'm really excited about. One is a graduate nurse who just started this year. So she's really fresh into the profession. And she lives, you know, 10 minutes away from me, and is, all she wants is a chat, sometimes to just debrief on her day. And then there's another lady who lives further up the hill from me, and she's an ER and emergency department nurse. She told me yesterday she did a 13-hour day. And I've been going and walking her dog, who's this adorable 12-week-old Rottweiler pup. And, you know, just the it's those little things that just give you so much joy and feeling of connectedness and just feeling of usefulness that I'm finding really, yeah, is what I'm finding a lot of pleasure in at the moment.
Just reminds me of that saying that the quickest way to help yourself is to help someone else. I don't know who said it.
Yeah. Mm. Absolutely.
Rachel, I'm interested with the idea of using energy, because I think we're going to start jumping into some of your activities in a sec. But yep. Just before we do, interested to, because I know energy is quite a, I guess, an abstract concept, as many of the things that we studied are, if not all. How do you sort of, how do you define energy and what's your working sort of constructs around it? And yep. Two, how can it be useful to the current situation?
Yep. So the particular form of energy that I'm really focused on is what's referred to as emotional energy. So when we think of human energy, there's three kind of types. So there's physical energy. So, you know, if you're feeling really tired because you've been working hard all day and you just want to go to sleep, you can think of your physical energy as depleted. We have what we call cognitive energy, which is how alert you are mentally. So again, if you've been studying hard all day, or maybe you've been, you know, wrangling kids all day, you might feel really mentally depleted. And then emotional energy can be a much more transient feeling that is connected to just how you feel in and of yourself. And often it's connected to our physical and mental energy. But I think we all know that feeling just when you just feel alive and when you feel energized. So when I talk about energy, I'm not talking about any kind of woo-woo-woo, you know, kind of, you know. Energy gets used a lot in sort of esoteric terms. I'm talking much more in a psychological way. You know, there's that feeling of like, yeah, I'm alive and I feel motivated and like I can do this, as opposed to feeling like, oh man, like, it was way too hard and I'm just really depleted. And the easiest way that I've found to explain the idea of energizing, because my particular area of interest is what we call relational energy, which is when you interact with someone or people, whether you walk away energized or depleted. And I'm sure we've all had those experiences of what I call the energy vampires, who, you know, sometimes there's people you just interact with them and you just walk away and you just feel drained. So that's the phenomena and the concept that I'm looking at. The degree to which you feel drained by someone or whether you feel energized by interacting with them.
It makes a whole bunch of sense to me, especially as a reformed energy vampire.
I cannot imagine that, Kesh. You're one of the most energizing people I know.
I've done a lot of changing, but I think I feel it every time we do the COVID convos. We get off this chat and every single one of us is just lifted through the experience. So we've had a lot of amazing energizers come on through the show. So that, you know, it might sound like a bit of a cognitive concept, but it's very visceral and you can feel it.
Yeah. And that's why I find it a particularly interesting thing, because it's something that people intuitively get, that, you know, everyone has had that experience of like, yeah, I feel more alive, or I feel really drained. And what the research around re-energizing is showing us is that these kinds of conversations that you've created are actually a really, really good recipe for building energy. So the kind of research and theory around it is that we're energized in situations where we are physically connected in some way. So most often it's physical, but this is a really interesting time and space to kind of look at, well, how do we create that simulation of shared physical presence? The second component is having shared emotion. So when we have some palpable emotion that we get in sync around, and then we can build on it through some kind of, let's call it ritual, but it's really based around having a shared focus. So the fact that we're all here together, we're, you know, connected on a single screen and we can all see each other. And because we're having a conversation that is meaningful, then we're able to build that shared emotion together. And so that's how we actually create an energizing interaction. So well done, you guys.
It's especially,
well, thank you.
It's especially interesting because I agree with what Kesha said, but it could be quite the opposite given the time of day that we're doing it. And I have been wrangling kids, especially in the last week or so, that the physical energy and the, well, maybe not the cognitive energy, but I'm probably lower in those, but then you can still get that emotional energy up, even if it's late in the day and you're tired in other areas.
Yeah. And this is what's kind of interesting, right? Because in most cases, you know, we think of classical physics, you know, there's this idea that energy can't be created or destroyed, it can only be transformed. But emotional energy seems to have this kind of different sort of phenomenon to it, which is that, you know, we can be drained in an instant from somebody, or we can be energized, you know, or we can be feeling kind of depleted and then something happens, you know, we can see something beautiful and our emotions are, we feel that shift. And so we've got a lot of flexibility around how we can use our emotional energy, and it can either serve us or not, depending on, you know, how aware we are of it and how much we can cultivate the conditions that, you know, will enable us to be energized.
So we've got a little bit of an experiment that we want to run today because Rachel has been so awesome. And we want to try to experiment with some ways how you, correct me if I'm wrong, Rachel, can lift up your emotional energy or be more energized.
Yep.
So basically how this works is we're about to play a song and Rachel is going to guide us through it. And if you want, join along at home. We're going to do our best to tell you about the experience and tell you how it works and how it feels, but definitely try it at home, and we'll experiment. So I'll bring this up onto my screen and Rachel, you can take it from here.
Yep. So what we're going to do, this is something that I do with my students, particularly at any point. So say if they've got big presentations due and they're feeling pretty anxious about, you know, performing in front of a group and having that sense of, ooh, you know, they're feeling a bit energetically dispersed, say. And music is a really powerful way of getting us in this rhythmic entrainment and also focusing in, isn't us in a shared, with a shared focus and with an emotional content, because music's often very emotive. So, and this also draws on the work of Amy Cuddy, who has done a lot of research around this idea of power posing. So if you're not familiar with power posing, this is the idea that you can use your physical body to make yourself feel more powerful or to deplete your sense of power and energy, right? So if you are slumped over like this, that will send your neurology into a state of sort of weakness and protection. Whereas, and what Amy's work shows is that if we stand more upright, and she often does what we call the Superman pose, which is a bit like this. I don't know if you can see it, but if you just imagine putting your hands on your hips like Wonder Woman or Superman, or the other way we can power pose is to put our arms straight up in the air in a kind of victory sign.
Think Rocky.
So, yeah, think Rocky, like, or someone who's just, you know, gone through and won the gold medal at the Olympics. So what we're going to do is, using Queen's We Will Rock You, because it's a, you know, energizing song. I've got a little sing-along version. It runs for about 2 minutes. And so what we're going to do is do the stomp and clap. So you guys are going to play along with me so that I'm not the only person making a complete fool of myself. And so what we're going to do, you can either do it with your hands or with your feet. So we go stomp, stomp, clap, stomp, stomp, clap to do the rhythm. We'll sing along with the words that appear on the screen. And then during the chorus, when we get to we will rock you, that's when we're going to do our power pose. So what I tend to do is, on the first we will, I put one arm up in the air. So I go, we will, and then with the second arm, we will, and then rock you. So that's it. So we're just going to sing along. We're going to stomp and clap during the verses. We're going to do our power posing during the choruses. And then there is a little bit of an instrumental break at the very end, which Kesh, you can either fade out, or we can just do our worst air guitaring at the end.
All right, let's see how this goes.
So I'll let you kick us off. And boys, you ready?
Yeah.
Let's do it. As I'll ever be. All right, kicking play now.
Nice playing in the band, gonna be a big man someday. You got blood on your face, big disgrace.
For Griggsy to open up into something big at the end there. I could see you warming up.
Visibly, I don't know the lyrics to We Will Rock You, so yeah.
But, you know, I think it's so simple, right? Everybody has that jam that just, you know, gets them onto another level. For me, it's Defying Gravity from Wicked. Just next level.
Yeah, yeah. Now, and of course, you know, that's if you want to be energized. So if you're struggling and things are really hard, and I know you had a chat with Peggy the other day about, you know, this collective grief that's happening at the moment, well, you know, you're not going to go and do that. But, you know, if you're in a situation where you kind of thinking, yeah, I actually want to feel a bit enlivened right now, that's just one of my little suggestions. But also just to connect. You know, and to listen to each other. So one of the big things that's come out of my research, when I asked people about the interactions that they experience that are energizing, one of the key things that's come out is that the people that they that energize me listen to me. So I think if we can create more space for listening, we're going to be a more energized and emotionally attuned community.
Thanks a lot for that, Rachel. That was very, very, very energizing. I loved I love getting moving. I can't tell you whether I actually loved being being videoed until I see actually what the video looks like. But it was definitely.
I can guarantee you, I will never watch this. It would be far too humiliating.
Maybe next time we do a combo of the no lights, no lycra, and Rachel's energizing.
Well, Rachel, we've run out of time. Before we sort of say our goodbyes, I was wondering if there's anything that we haven't touched on that you wouldn't that you would like to before we wind up.
Nothing that comes to mind. If you guys have any other questions about what I'm doing, what's working for me. Otherwise, just thanks for having me. It's been really a delight.
Rachel, I'm wondering about, I know you said before about what you're finding really energizes you is people listening. Is that a common experience for people, or does it vary? And it's vary according to personality type. Like, is that for particular, you know, whether it's introvert or extrovert or whatever it might be?
In my research, I haven't dug deeply into the actual personalities. So what I've been doing is just asking across a range of people to describe to me the interactions with people that they've found energizing, and to think about the people that they find energizing, and then to describe to me either what happens in those interactions that they think is the cause of the energy, or what is it about that person that they find particularly energizing. And it's just been a very strong theme through that response is, you know, there's a whole host of things that are going on and that people describe as energizing. But I think it just comes down to that thing of being seen. So another big thing that's come out is that people are energized in situations where they feel they can be their authentic self. And I think when people are in environments where they're being listened to, then they're being seen and acknowledged and seen for who they are. They're not feeling like who I am isn't good enough or I've got a sense of myself here. They can just be real and the person is actually being present and listening to them. And I think that that's part of a big part of why, you know, they're saying, they listen to me. Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot, Rachel, and really appreciated you taking the time out to explain all of that to us today and to also energize us at the same time.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me, guys.
Thanks a lot to everyone who's tuned in, and we'd as always request that you share, like, and subscribe with your friends and anyone else you consider worthwhile sharing with. In the meantime, guys, you stay healthy, world.